On the 26th of April, 1986, the Chernobyl nuclear power plant burst open, releasing a massive amount of radiation which rendered a 1,000 square mile area completely uninhabitable. Then, a couple weeks ago, there was an explosion at an oil refinery in Philadelphia, just a couple miles from my house. My dad actually heard the explosion and ran upstairs to see if a bookshelf had fallen over, but I just slept through the whole thing. Now, I had just recently watched the Chernobyl miniseries on HBO, so when I woke up in the morning, I remember feeling grateful that it was just an oil refinery and not a nuclear power plant that had exploded. Because if it had been a nuclear plant, then the entire city of Philadelphia would have needed to be evacuated. But then I thought to myself, is that really a fair comparison? Because in the 50 years that we've had nuclear energy, there have only been 3 noteworthy accidents. While oil spills, dam collapses, and coal mining accidents occur at a far greater rate. So I decided to do some research into this topic with one question in mind. Would expanding our use of nuclear energy make my life any better? The short answer is that it's complicated, but for the longer answer, I'll be looking at 3 main aspects of nuclear energy: its cost, its safety, and its environmental impact. Now, before we can get into that, it is helpful to have at least a rudimentary understanding of how a nuclear power plant actually works, so here are the basic facts you need to know. Almost all nuclear energy is produced through nuclear fission. For this process to begin, you start by digging up uranium and then enriching it, which means increasing the proportion of uranium-235, which is the rarer but more reactive form of uranium. Once you've enriched it, you then put that uranium into fuel rods, and then at a nuclear power plant, neutrons are fired into those rods, starting a nuclear chain reaction. A single neutron is able to split a uranium-235 atom, releasing energy as well as additional neutrons. Those other neutrons then split other atoms, releasing more energy and more neutrons, and so the reaction continues. Ultimately, this chain reaction releases a great deal of energy, which is then used to convert water into pressurized steam. And then that steam is used to spin a turbine really fast, which finally produces electricity. As of now, about 10% of the world's electricity is produced through nuclear power. So, now that we have a basic understanding of how nuclear energy works, we can get into the first area we want to explore: its cost. Now, I am admittedly a big consumer of electricity. From my phone, to my laptop, to my lights, to my air conditioner, etc. But I have, to this day, never had to pay an electricity bill. That's my parents' job, but will become my job in the near future, which is a bit of a scary thought. But what I want to know is, will transitioning to a greater use of nuclear power make my future electricity bill any lower? And the answer is maybe. In 2015, the Energy Information Administration published a study into the levelized cost of electricity for various sources of energy, and here's what they predicted for 2020. So nuclear is right there in the middle, in the same price range as coal. And if we want to ignore coal and the other fossil fuels because we're hoping to transition away from them, then there are still some renewable energy sources that are clearly cheaper than nuclear, including hydro, offshore wind, and geothermal. The main reason for nuclear energy's so-so rating when it comes to cost is that a nuclear power plant is pretty clearly an expensive thing to build. They're big and they're complex. In addition to that, the Union of Concerned Scientists reports that cost estimates for building a new nuclear power plant have actually gone up in recent years, from around $3 billion in the early 2000s to $9 billion in 2009. The good news is that once you've built a nuclear power plant, it's actually pretty inexpensive to run it. The main cost is obtaining the fuel, but uranium is surprisingly inexpensive. On Earth, uranium is actually 500 times more abundant than gold, and like 800 times cheaper. I might even go out and buy a chunk of uranium myself. Just kidding, NSA. I am not suspicious. Plus, there's the fact that you would have to enrich the uranium, and that can be an expensive process. But again, the main barrier to entry for any private company that wants to get involved in producing nuclear energy is the cost of building a nuclear power plant. Since these costs can run so high, the government has actually had to step in and grant subsidies to companies involved in producing nuclear energy. So, if transitioning to nuclear power meant that my electricity bill went down, but my taxes went up to finance the nuclear power industry, then sorry to the IRS, but that doesn't seem like much of a win. And of course, there is the fact that, generally, the safer you want your power plant to be, the more expensive it's going to be to build, which does seem like it gives companies an incentive to cut corners and create unsafe power plants. With that in mind, let's move on to considering the overall safety of nuclear power. Now, obviously, anything involving nuclear energy sounds scary, because radioactive materials emit super-fast, high-energy particles that can tear through the cells of living beings. But, in spite of this, nuclear energy is actually a lot safer than you might realize. Forbes collected the data on the global death tolls of various sources of energy from any deaths involved in mining, construction, or diseases related to that energy source. And here's what they found. See where nuclear is? It's actually at the very bottom. This chart, by the way, is measured in deaths per petawatt hour of energy produced. And one petawatt hour is about the amount of electricity that the entire world consumes in 2 weeks. So, in other words, this chart is essentially telling us that if we want to meet the world's electricity needs for 2 weeks, and we do it using coal, then we can expect about 100,000 people to die in the process, assuming safety standards remain how they have been in the past. If we decide to do it using hydro, that number drops to 1,400 deaths. But if we do it using nuclear energy, the number is only 90 deaths on average. To most of us, this is probably quite surprising, as we often think of nuclear as this massively dangerous energy source. But, as I mentioned in the beginning, the fact that there have only been 3 big nuclear disasters in the technology's entire history is actually a pretty good sign. The first was Three Mile Island, in my home state of Pennsylvania, which was not as much of a disaster as a potential disaster. From what we know, not a single person died. Then there was Chernobyl, which was a technological failure mixed with extreme mismanagement. As a result, at least 4,000 people died from radiation poisoning, or more commonly, radiation-induced cancer. Most recently, we had Fukushima. Now, there are estimated to be no deaths caused by radiation from Fukushima, but the evacuation process may have killed over 2,000 people, mainly the elderly. So clearly, whenever there's a nuclear accident, it's a tragedy. Hundreds of people can die, and thousands of people are forced to leave their homes, never to return. And yet, these are the tragedies that we carry in our minds because we hear about them. What we rarely hear about are the thousands of people who die every year in coal mining accidents. The news rarely mentions the hundreds of thousands of people who die every year from breathing in air polluted by coal and oil, which is especially a big problem in developing countries. These kinds of deaths have become so commonplace that we don't even think about them, despite the fact that they could be avoided if we just transition to other energy sources. Plus, that chart that I showed earlier doesn't include any indirect deaths caused by climate change. So, once global warming starts to really kick in, we can expect the death counts of fossil fuels to be a whole lot higher than they are now. So, all things considered, nuclear energy is proven to be the least deadly way to produce electricity. And with each passing decade, there are new designs for how to make nuclear power plants even safer. But there is one element of safety that I haven't mentioned yet. If we want to spread nuclear energy to other countries, that can often go hand in hand with spreading nuclear weapons. Both technologies require that country to build centrifuges which can enrich uranium. Now, the uranium used in nuclear power plants only needs to be enriched to around 3-5% purity, while a nuclear weapon requires uranium enriched to the 90% purity level. This may sound like a big leap, but it's actually not that difficult. The biggest hurdle is enriching uranium from its natural form to the 3-5% enrichment level. Then, the same centrifuges can be used to get it to the 90% level, albeit on a larger scale. This is why Iran has been in the news for violating the nuclear deal and enriching uranium to 4.5%. This is still far off from 90, but does put Iran on the potential path towards developing a nuclear bomb. So, the proliferation of nuclear weapons is a key argument against the spread of nuclear power. In response, one could argue that, for now, nuclear power should only be utilized by countries that already have nuclear weapons. Alternately, other countries should be allowed to develop their own nuclear power programs, but only under strict scrutiny from the international community, to ensure that they don't use their enrichment facilities to create nuclear weapons. This was the idea behind the original Iran nuclear deal, which had the support of many scientists and politicians. But a final aspect of nuclear energy that poses a significant risk to humans and the environment is the creation of nuclear waste. With that in mind, let's talk about nuclear energy's environmental impact. Nuclear power is often promoted as a clean alternative to other energy sources. But something that calls this into question is the fact that nuclear power plants produce large amounts of radioactive waste. When properly contained, this waste can do no harm to humans or to the environment, but it has to remain in containment for hundreds or thousands of years before it can become completely harmless. Figuring out how and where to store waste for thousands of years has proven to be quite a challenge, as you have to factor in all sorts of natural disasters, from earthquakes to tsunamis. For that reason, most of the world's nuclear waste is technically in temporary storage as we seek out a way to store it permanently. The only country that is officially building a permanent nuclear waste repository is Finland. This facility is dug out deep into the country's bedrock and is designed to last for 100,000 years. For decades, the United States has tried to develop our own nuclear storage facility, but we've failed, mainly because no one wants nuclear waste to be stored in their home state. That's completely reasonable. I don't want it here either. But eventually, if we do want nuclear power to be a safe and clean source of energy, we will need to find somewhere to put a permanent storage facility. And while an accident involving nuclear waste could have lasting detrimental effects, those effects would still be localized to a specific area. On the other hand, the looming threat to the environment on a planetary scale is, of course, global warming. Global warming, as you probably know, is primarily caused by the release of carbon dioxide when we burn fossil fuels. Nuclear energy offers us a way to produce a lot of electricity with almost no carbon dioxide emissions. Now, I know I've thrown a lot of charts at you this episode, but here's one last one. This data, collected by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, compares energy sources based on the amount of carbon dioxide released per kilowatt hour of electricity produced. In this regard, nuclear energy is one of the cleanest, ranking only behind wind. The only reason nuclear energy has any carbon dioxide associated with it is because some fossil fuels are used to provide the energy for the mining, enrichment, and construction processes. By the way, the smoke you see coming out of nuclear power plants is actually just steam. And no, it's not radioactive steam, because it's not from the water that comes into direct contact with the fuel. So, in all honesty, nuclear energy's tiny carbon footprint is one of the only reasons this technology is worth discussing. As we saw in the cost section, nuclear is pretty much in the middle when it comes to the price tag of producing electricity. The safety section was similarly mixed. Nuclear has a surprisingly good track record when it comes to its death toll, but also has the potential to lead to the proliferation of nuclear weapons. Then, in the environment section, we saw that nuclear's carbon footprint is excellent, but its radioactive waste poses a real problem. Overall, nuclear power seems like a really mixed bag. However, now's a good time to mention that over the course of my research for this episode, I came across several sources that promoted thorium-based reactors as the future of nuclear power, instead of the uranium-based reactors that we mostly use today. Using thorium instead of uranium has the potential to lower the cost, increase the safety, and decrease the amount of radioactive waste produced by nuclear power plants. Now, it is still mostly theoretical, and it comes with its own problems, but countries like China and India are planning to build thorium-based nuclear power plants in the near future. So, it's definitely something to keep your eye on, and if you want to learn more, I'll link to relevant sources in the description. All things considered, do you believe we should expand our use of nuclear power? I'll leave a poll in this video. I think you need to click in the upper right-hand corner to respond to it. My personal answer would be a tentative yes. I think that the low carbon footprint aspect of nuclear power is just too important to ignore. Unfortunately, we're in desperate times where we need to consider any energy sources that can help us prevent global warming. So I am comfortable saying that nuclear energy is definitely better than fossil fuels like coal and oil. But is it better than renewable energy sources like solar and wind? That's a tougher question. And to fully answer that, I think I'm going to eventually need to make a video examining the pros and cons of renewable energy sources. But I hope you enjoyed this look into the world of nuclear energy. Feel free to send this video to your friends who love nuclear power, or hate nuclear power, or don't know anything about nuclear power. And stay tuned for my next video. I promise it's going to be an exciting one.